Kia ora e te whanau. My name is Chikita, and I'm the founder of Allied Justice Aotearoa. Welcome to our sixth episode in the Women in Leadership series. In this episode, I will be in conversation with Paula Tesoriero, who is the Disability Rights Commissioner for the New Zealand Human Rights Commission. It is her role to protect and promote the rights of disabled New Zealanders. Paula is chief de mission for the New Zealand Paralympic team heading to Tokyo. She is also a Paralympian cycling gold medalist, a former lawyer, was a general manager at Stats New Zealand and at the Ministry of Justice. She is a life trustee with the Halberg Foundation and has held a range of governance roles on various boards. And she's also a mum. Paula is an embodiment of determination and resilience, and her story is one that you cannot miss. I cannot wait for you all to hear all that she has to say today. So without further ado, I introduce you all to Paula Tesoriero.
What was your journey like to becoming a disability rights commissioner?
So, interestingly, I don't think I ever saw this as a child as being a role or a space that I would end up in. But there were a few things that really stood out for me in my childhood growing up as a disabled child in New Zealand. And I'll use that language throughout the interview to reflect the social model of disability, which New Zealand disabled people prefer, which says I'm not disabled by the impairment that I have, but rather I'm disabled by the barriers that society puts in place, which creates disability. And so we use the term disabled people as our preference to reflect that social model. So growing up as a young disabled person in New Zealand, I was acutely aware that it seemed to me the only way to fit in was to pretend that I was not disabled. So I spent so much of my child and young adulthood really trying to hide disability. And I studied, went off to university and did law and politics, and then I went and practiced law in a law firm, and then I did legal and policy work in some government agencies. And in parallel with that career journey, I started cycling a bit more seriously. I'd always ridden a bike. It was a way of creating freedom for me. And so I'd always loved riding a bike. And when I started to get really serious about my cycling goals, I worked out that, well, actually, I'm going to have to out myself as a disabled person if I wanted to compete at the Paralympic Games. So I went on that journey of really integrating disability into my identity, and that created a much more authentic me and a me who could, I guess, bring my whole self to whatever I did. And so I had a really successful cycling career, and at the end of that, I wanted to find a way to give back, and so I got really involved in a number of disability and sporting organizations, and that really further fueled my passion for wanting to do more for disabled people. So when this role as the Disability Rights Commissioner came up, it was this perfect blend of law and policy and disability and advocacy and, you know, all the things that I felt would enable me to do the best I could to help in collaboration with others, you know, really advance the rights of disabled people. And so that's where I'm at.
What is your role as a Disability Rights Commissioner?
So my role sits in the Human Rights Commission, and the statutory function comes from the Human Rights Act. And broadly speaking, it's around protecting and promoting the rights of disabled people. And so I do that in a number of ways, which is through advocacy on big systemic issues. So things like health and education and employment and, you know, those really big sort of topics and rocks, which create many of the barriers that disabled people find ourselves facing. And so I advocate with local government, central government, with the private sector, you know, basically trying to urge people who have that decision-making responsibility and authority to really think about the impact on disabled people. So in terms of those big systemic issues that I'm focused on, they're around housing, addressing violence and abuse, improving employment and education outcomes, improving data and evidence around the disability population, equitable access to healthcare, and then finally, really trying to initiate a national conversation about attitudes towards disability and disabled people. And I spend most of my time obviously doing that domestically, but I also do have some global roles. And so I also represent a perspective from Aotearoa New Zealand to some of the global bodies that we are part of. One of the things that I don't do is get involved in individual complaints that come to the Human Rights Commission. So we have an inquiries and complaints team that deal with complaints from people who feel that they have been discriminated against under one of the grounds in the Human Rights Act. And they are for individuals, families, organisations to come and have those complaints resolved, primarily through mediation and some other ways. And that's a chunk of the work of the commission. But what I do, sort of separate from that, is really focus on advocacy at that systemic level.
What are some of the challenges that the disability community experienced before the pandemic, and how were these challenges impacted during the pandemic?
I think it's fair to say that the pandemic has really shone the light on existing gaps for disabled people. And I think, in a way, you know, if there's anything positive to take from this year, then I think there is a positive aspect to that, because I think it really has raised the profile of disability issues and of the inequities that exist for disabled people. You know, and disabled people make up 24% of New Zealand's population, so, you know, it's nearly a quarter of our population. So I was really involved right from the word go around the pandemic and monitoring the impact and trying to escalate issues with government as they arose. I think those existing gaps across things like access to appropriate, affordable and accessible housing, and an education system which is not as inclusive as it could be, employment not being at the same level as non-disabled people as it needs to be. In fact, employment for disabled people, the stat that I typically use is that for disabled people, the unemployment rate is nearly twice that of non-disabled people. There's a range of health issues for disabled people in terms of access to healthcare and access to supports. And, you know, a recent public health survey just came out a couple of weeks ago, which indeed revealed that disabled people had poorer outcomes on a range of fronts than non-disabled people. And, you know, all of those issues, plus key ones around not having cities and transport, which is accessible, really came to the fore during the pandemic. So, you know, we saw situations of people's access to personal protective equipment in the community. You know, people who require other people to come into their homes and provide support, you know, not being able to get personal protective equipment. We saw during the pandemic that information that was coming out about COVID-19 was not accessible for all in the community, which meant that actually we had disabled people not getting information until hours, days, sometimes weeks later than the rest of the population. And that is absolutely not good enough in a situation where communication during a crisis is so important for people. You know, we saw that there were instances of disabled children being left behind and being able to keep up with their education during lockdown because of partly the digital divide, but also, you know, there are young disabled people who, you know, require teacher aid support or require very tactile ways of learning and hard copy resources. And certainly, you know, the Ministry of Education worked really hard to bring that on board later, but there was an initial understandable delay in some ways, but not acceptable all the same. And, you know, there were situations during the pandemic of disabled people not being able to access some of the basic necessities of life, and so access to food was an issue. And it was an issue for people in a way that it hadn't been in the past, because all of a sudden, you know, you had supermarkets opening up online shopping spots, which were then quickly taken by people who didn't want to go to supermarkets, but actually for some disabled people who critically needed those online shopping spots and they weren't prioritised, meant that there were instances of people relying on emergency welfare for food. And then, you know, at the best of times, our transport system is not as accessible as it needs to be. And so during COVID, when people needed to rely on even more reduced services to get to essential places, it wasn't always possible. So, you know, I think that there were a range of issues which COVID really shone the light on. And while it's really disappointing and negative, I think the positive of it is that it has really brought to the fore some of those issues and has really raised awareness within a number of agencies of those inequities that exist.
Do you think the government has responded appropriately to the needs of the disability community so far?
You know, advocacy within the disability community goes back decades. And, you know, I'm really privileged to be in a role where I stand on the shoulders of giants who have just done so much work so that people of my generation and disabled young people today experience a better situation than in the past. But we still have a really long way to go. And, you know, if people are interested in reading more about that, they can read the report of the Independent Monitoring Mechanism, which is myself, the Health Ombudsman, and the Disabled Persons Organisation Coalition, and together we have a role in monitoring compliance with the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And that report highlights that notwithstanding progress in a number of areas for New Zealand, but actually we have a long way to go. And I think, you know, that every government, and indeed this government, has a work program, you know, that has some potentially really exciting things on its agenda for disabled people. But I also think disabled people are at a point where we really want to see that change on the ground happen quickly. And this year has really highlighted the need for that. I think in terms of the government's response to issues raised during COVID, I mean, it's been, you know, it's been said before, we were in these, you know, really unprecedented times. And, you know, there were certainly moves to try and work with disabled people and respond to things. But, you know, it was pretty difficult for people. I think now that we're in this recovery phase, know, I and others have been really advocating for disabled people to be front and centre as we build back to a better New Zealand. So that means that we're really thinking quite differently about access to healthcare, and that we create an inclusive education system, that we put disabled people front and centre when we think about employment, and there are things like shovel-ready projects and initiatives aimed at, you know, kickstarting the economy, that, you know, we really are thinking about the talent that exists within the disability community. So, you know, I think disability advocacy has been around for a long time and progress has been made, but, you know, there's still a lot more to do, and this year has really, really highlighted that.
The issue of accessibility has been a common part of human rights discourse, particularly when talking about the disability community. What improvements at a policy level do you think need to be made to increase access on the ground and look after some of the most vulnerable people in our community?
I think there's a number of things. I think there are a number of issues that need addressing. One of the proposals that the government is progressing in partnership with disabled people is a new legislative framework to improve accessibility over time. The intention is for that bill to be introduced into Parliament by the end of next year. And essentially it's a bill that would provide a framework for accessibility with some standards that would sit underneath it that would then be monitored and regulated. And the idea is that that would sort of set the standard, really, for what accessibility looks like in New Zealand. And I'm really supportive of this legislation. I think that will be really important, that it's able to look at some of those intersectional issues, making sure that it's done in a way in true partnership with tangata whenua, and that disabled people have the real opportunity to have input. I think that because, you know, disabled women, for example, face particular barriers, and the legislation at this stage doesn't include that intersectional approach, it might not address all of the barriers, but I do think it's a really positive step forward. I think one of the other big things that I have really learnt in my role is that you can have some great policy and some great legislation and, you know, across a number of areas, but fundamentally, if we don't change attitudes around disability and towards disabled people, and we don't really have a national conversation about these things, then I don't think we will make the change that we need to make as a country. So I'm all for, you know, really big policy change across a number of areas, and I'm very involved in advocating for those. And then in parallel, really trying to make sure that we have this national conversation about attitudes. And I'm hoping that if we can start to change attitudes, then it will be very straightforward to improve accessibility, you know, both that sort of that community local government level as well as central government policies.
Oftentimes when policies are implemented, you rightly mentioned that to take effect at a ground level takes some time or doesn't normally happen as swiftly as we would want it to be. Do you think this is primarily because we are not having a national conversation about the disability community and the issues that impact them, or are there other issues as well?
I think a range of things affect how quickly policies developed. I think, you know, one of the things that I always want to see more of is disabled people at the table contributing to policy development, and, you know, I think that that would make our policy development effective and efficient. So I think that's one issue. I think policy development generally gets caught up in, you know, priorities of the day. I think with COVID now and the economic impact and you know, the impact on government debt and things, you know, inevitably has the potential to slow some things down, but then accelerate some other things as well. I think that the need for a national conversation is, you know, needs to be seen as something which is in parallel to policy change. And it's really about trying to unlock what might drive some of those attitudes and then really try and shift them so that, you know, disability is embraced and we can reduce stigma and, you know, through that hopefully also help change current poor outcomes.
What can our community do to become a better ally to the disability community?
I think it's always about, you know, educating oneself and critiquing one's own thoughts and actions, you know, getting familiar with what ableism is and then really challenging people's own assumptions and misconceptions about disability. I think that sort of change always begins with oneself and, you know, then sort of going from there. I think always important to watch the language that's used and making sure that preferred terms are used. So, you know, people come up with a lot of terms for disabled people, and actually the preference is that we are called disabled people. So I think letting disabled people do their own self-identifying is really important. I think it's important to ask questions too, you know, like many people say to me that, you know, they are nervous about getting the language wrong or asking the wrong questions. And I think, you know, we have to be prepared as a disability community to make sure that we're not putting barriers up to people asking questions and trying to educate themselves. So it is a, you know, it's a two-way thing on that front. I think, you know, the other thing that the community can do is, you know, make sure there's space at the table, and school boards of trustees, community groups, local government, central government, that, you know, right through the country, and boardrooms, you know, are really opening up opportunities and not directly or indirectly limiting opportunities for disabled people to stand for different groups, or, you know, be represented on different groups and getting that voice through. And that's part of, you know, not speaking for disabled people, but allowing the space for involvement. No, I personally think that disability should be a majority issue in New Zealand, because with 24% of our population being disabled, and that 24% being connected to friends and family, you know, it doesn't take long before you hit more than 50% of the country. And so I really think that amplifying our voices and supporting our voices is really important.
How can individuals get in touch with you if they would like to offer some feedback?
People can contact me through our website, which is hrc.co.nz, and there's a range of ways that the website talks about contacting me. You know, I'm also on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter, so people can contact me through social media.
And our final question today is, what advice would you offer to students that want to work in the human rights space?
I think in Aotearoa it's really important that people learn about Te Tiriti or Waitangi and its role in our history. At the Commission, we're on our own journey of becoming a treaty-based organisation, and more human rights and civil society organisations are also on that same journey. I think if people feel passionate about an area of social injustice or human rights, then learning more about that and who is impacted and how, I think, you know, being curious about why things happen, why injustice is caused, trying to understand things from a really different perspective than might have shaped your own upbringing or your own set of experience is really important. And I think the more I've been in my role, the more I've began to understand this term intersectionality, which, you know, we use in everyday human rights language, but actually at its core, what it gets to is, you know, very few of us have one identity. We can have multiple identities, and being able to work across those and find space for those is, you know, is really important. I really think that people who are interested in working in human rights, you know, it's great to have an understanding of those international human rights instruments and then the domestic laws and obligations. So, you know, people will want to understand the UN Declaration of Human Rights and, you know, the instruments that come out of that. If people are interested in disability, then understanding the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities and how, you know, New Zealand should be upholding those. One of the books that I really recommend is Sir Robert Martin's book, which is called Becoming a Person, and it tells the story of Sir Robert growing up in an institution as a person with a learning disability, and, you know, he's just been re-elected to the UN Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. I think volunteering is important, so, you know, gaining some experience in particular organisations that people are interested in, you know, getting in amongst it and learning more about it. I think in terms of students wanting paid work, you know, thinking about where they can best contribute their strengths and interests and experience and skills. So, you know, organisations like Human Rights Watch, Human Rights Commission, Amnesty International, Women's Refuge, UNICEF, you know, organisations like that. There's also roles in advocacy as lawyers and communications or generally in management and administration. So it can be a really broad area that you can use your specific strengths and skills to apply to, you know, a broad human rights interest that you have. I think, you know, studying things like law, political systems, sociology and history are all important. Having said that, I regularly come across people around the world who have studied all sorts of things and got into human rights. So, you know, people are now, of course, studying, you know, environmental studies and climate change and, you know, various other things. And then I think, you know, last but not least, of course, is talking and listening to people. So, you know, discussing human rights issues with friends and family and people who you might not know so well. I think the more we learn from each other, the more we sort of, I think, can understand the true essence of human rights, which is about the dignity of people and, you know, all being born free and, you know, equal in dignity and rights, and, you know, really sort of talking about those things and what leads to inequities and how to resolve them. So I think there's lots that students can do and learn and, you know, keep asking questions and I'm sure that we will continue to grow as a country if we do that.
I would like to thank Paula for sharing her valuable time and expertise with us. I personally learned a lot through this career. Well, folks, that is all for this episode of Women in Leadership. If you would like to listen to our previous episode, Devika Partiman, Changing Dutch Politics One Vote at a Time, the link will be provided in the description box below. Make sure to support our work by liking and sharing this video and subscribing to our YouTube channel. Do not forget to follow us on our social media handles to stay up to date on all our content. See you all in the next episode.